In this video, we would like to introduce you to the concept of the cloning cycle. The cloning cycle is a series of steps frequently performed iteratively during the creation of a molecular clone. By understanding the role of each of these steps in the cloning cycle, you should learn how these phases of a cloning experiment fit together when you are developing a complex molecular product. The steps of the cloning cycle are outlined here. First, manipulation of DNA. Second, transformation of DNA into a bacterial host. Third, selection and screening for candidate recombinant molecules. Fourth, extraction of candidate recombinant molecules from bacteria. Fifth, analysis of candidate recombinant molecules. In a simple cloning experiment, you may need to accurately insert a DNA fragment into your plasmid, passing through steps 1 through 5 one time. More complex cloning experiments will require you to cycle through the steps 2 or more times. Let's explore what happens at each of the 5 steps. Step 1, manipulation of DNA. The purpose of this step is to generate a novel recombinant molecule. We have discussed the use of a plasmid as a vector to propagate a DNA fragment of interest. In yellow, we can see our intact plasmid or cloning vector. Next to that, we can see a representative genomic DNA depicted in red and blue. The red fragment is the piece that we would like to clone, which we will refer to as the fragment of interest. The blue represents extraneous material. The classic approach to this step is the use of restriction enzymes, which we will elaborate on in a dedicated video series. Even later, we will discuss the great variety of ways in which DNA can be manipulated in the plasmid cloning cycle without touching a restriction enzyme. Restriction enzymes are often described as molecular scissors, which are capable of cutting DNA at specific sequences. As long as the plasmid and the insert DNA have been cut with one or more restriction enzymes that create compatible ends, those fragments can be ligated back together using an enzyme called DNA ligase. Let's take a closer look. After treatment with restriction enzymes, our plasmid has become linear. Separately, we will treat the source of our fragment of interest with the same restriction enzymes, creating DNA fragments, including our fragment of interest, shown in red. After ligation, there are 3 possible outcomes. The vector can re-ligate back to itself, a blue fragment can ligate into the vector, the red fragment can ligate into the vector. When we are done with our cloning experiment, we want to identify a correct clone, one in which the red fragment has been ligated into the empty vector. In an optimal cloning experiment, 90 to 100% of your clones have the desired fragment of interest. Step 2, transformation. Before we can analyze candidate clones, we will introduce the DNA mixture into bacterial cells and allow the bacteria to make copies for us. Bacteria have a natural tendency to absorb genetic material in their environments. Scientists have learned how to optimize this process. The most common technique used in labs is chemically competent cells. Electroporation is a great alternative if your lab has an electroporator. With either technique, chemical transformation or electroporation, a very small proportion of cells are induced to take DNA from the surrounding environment. This is where the selectable marker on your DNA vector comes into play. Step 3, selection and screening. After you have transformed your ligation mixture into bacteria, you now potentially have a complex population of bacteria. Some bacteria might not have survived transformation. Some are still viable, but did not take up DNA. Since we included an antibiotic resistance gene on the plasmid, we can select for those bacteria which acquired a functional plasmid. Then, if necessary, we can also apply a screening technique to guarantee that we will be looking at recombinant plasmid in our next step. Let's take a moment to talk about selection and screening separately. Step 3A, selection. Once DNA has been introduced into the competent bacteria, the bacteria are generally allowed to recover and are then plated on auger plates for growth. Because our plasmid has an antibiotic resistance gene on it and we are including antibiotics in the media, only cells that have received circularized plasmid during the transformation will be able to grow. This process is called selection. As we mentioned above, there are 3 types of plasmids that could result from our cloning: plasmid with no insert, plasmid with the wrong insert, plasmid with the correct insert. All of these plasmids will promote growth of bacteria in the presence of antibiotics. Our next job is to figure out which of the clones are the ones with the correct insert. Depending on the cloning technique used, there may be many or just a few desired clones on your plate. This is referred to as cloning efficiency. If your cloning reaction is highly efficient, most of your clones will have the correct insert. Ideally, your cloning reaction is 100% efficient with all clones having the correct insert. If for some reason you observe or anticipate a high proportion of clones which have no insert, you have the option of eliminating erroneous clones by screening. Step 3b, screening. Screening is a general term distinct from selection where you need to examine your sample for a specific phenotype. When necessary, screening and selection are done at the same time because the majority of plasmids contain the lac-Z alpha fragment that allows for the common selection technique known as blue-white selection. In order to apply selection to your transformation, you simply need to change the growth conditions. Let's take a closer look at our plasmid and the elements involved. Most plasmids contain a multi-cloning site, and it is generally located within the lac-Z alpha gene fragment. When a plasmid like this is intact, lac-Z alpha is also intact. Lac-Z alpha encodes a small protein fragment that allows certain E. coli to form a complete beta-galactosidase protein. Beta-galactosidase is an enzyme whose normal substrate is lactose. Several chemicals have been identified that will change color upon exposure to beta-galactosidase, including the commonly used X-gal, which turns blue. When lac-Z alpha has been disrupted by cloning into the multi-cloning site, it can no longer complete the production of functional beta-galactosidase. As a result, chemical substrates will not be activated to change color. In short, a recircularized empty vector will contain an intact lac-Z alpha fragment. Bacteria carrying this plasmid can turn blue. In contrast, if an insert has disrupted the lac-Z alpha fragment, it is no longer functional. These colonies, therefore, remain white. The plate on this slide shows examples of colonies carrying empty vector, which are the blue colonies, and colonies carrying a vector which has acquired a fragment within the multi-cloning site. These are the white colonies. Again, depending on your cloning strategy, you might not perform the screen, but many plasmids carry the lac-Z alpha fragment to provide this option. At this point, let's start putting these steps together. As summarized in this slide, you can see our starting material, which we can refer to generically as a vector and a fragment of interest. In this example, manipulation of the DNA is being done with restriction enzymes and ligase. After manipulating the DNA, we transform bacteria and allow the bacteria to reproduce. Bacteria will be exposed to an antibiotic, such as ampicillin, so that only bacteria carrying a circular plasmid can grow. At this point, we have the option of screening bacterial colonies as well to see if they carry an insert. Step 4, extraction from bacteria. Once candidate clones have been identified, we need to inoculate small bacterial cultures so that we can extract sufficient DNA for analysis. We will extract the DNA using a routine procedure called the DNA mini-prep. There are many DNA mini-prep kits on the market. Once purified, we will analyze the DNA to see if our fragment of interest has been introduced. Step 5, clone verification. Now that we have isolated DNA back out of the bacteria, we need to verify which clone or clones are the ones we are after. Let's take a quick look at these options. By far and away, the most authoritative method for this purpose is sequencing. You can also do a quick restriction digest to get an idea if you have the correct size insert. Another option would be a diagnostic PCR reaction. Pros and cons of these choices will be discussed later. However, it is important to be 100% sure your clone is accurate before proceeding to the next step in your experiment. Now that we have looked at these steps separately, let's put all of the steps of the cloning cycle together in a flowchart. First, you manipulate your DNA sources. In this example, we referred to classic restriction enzyme cloning, which uses restriction enzymes and ligase to create novel recombinant molecules. Next, you transform your mixture of DNA into E. coli. Third, following transformation, you plate your transformed bacteria on media that will select for bacteria that have taken up plasmid. At this point, you may also choose to screen for candidate clones. In the next step, you extract the candidate plasmid DNA using a routine mini-prep. Finally, you analyze your DNA to determine if your DNA manipulation was successful. There are three possible outcomes. The first outcome is that the clone is not correct. If this is the case, you will most likely return to the top of the flowchart to manipulation of DNA, possibly including some troubleshooting. The next possible outcome is that the clone is correct, but you desire to modify it. In this case, you return to the top of the flowchart and do another manipulation to your DNA. The final possible outcome is that the clone is correct and it is your desired finished product. In this case, you will proceed with other aspects of your experiment. Steps 2 through 4, transformation, selection, and extraction of DNA, are extremely routine. Analysis of your cloning products or clone verification is essential, but there are really only a few options to choose from. You will have the most flexibility when you are manipulating your DNA. Our upcoming videos will get into the various techniques you can choose from as you plan your cloning project. To learn more about molecular cloning, visit snapgene.com.